the guy in this previous document was talking about, that right. they was kept on bringing up the name Prison Industrial Complex.
Right. Now we're finna get into the agenda and the main points of the prison yep. industry complex.
It says, Prison Industrial Complex is a term we use to describe the overlapping interests of government and industry that uses surveillance, policing, and imprisonment as solutions to what are, in actuality, economic, social, and political problems.
Right. Now, let me read that one more time for me. Okay. We'll go word for word.
Okay. Prison Industrial Complex is a term we use to describe the overlapping interests of government and industry.
Now, you hear that, right? The mm-hmm. interests mm-hmm. of who? The government and industry.
Yep. That use surveillance.
Right. Now, that can be twofold surveillance. It can be surveillance as off the TV.
Yep.
It can be surveillance as what you see these officers surveillance you with their technology.
Yep.
Called the FBI, the NSA, yep. IRS.
Policing.
Yeah. And that's what they've been doing, policing. And I really call it occupying
yep.
our neighborhood.
Yep.
This is the justification.
Yep. And imprisonment.
Right, and imprisonment. Because it's been a war on gangs and a war on crime.
Yep.
But it was to imprison who? The Israelites.
God, blacks, lines, and Native Americans. As solutions to what are, in actuality, economic.
What's that they all get in prison houses? Description.
Dang, I forgot. Okay, like I said, economic.
Right, because what's really going on mm-hmm. is, and the reason why we ended up in those situations, and the real solution to our situation problem is we don't have no economics.
Yep.
Meaning, first of all, the average black don't even know what economics mean and yep. don't know how do it works in his life to make him a productive male or woman. Mm-hmm.
Okay, say social.
Right, social. Meaning to be social and to socialize. That's why they have programs, outreach programs for young youth
yep.
to teach them how to fill out applications.
Yeah, merging networks.
Oh,
yeah, the networking. Basically, the networking business. That's where your so-called social life comes from, is the different avenues that they network in. Well, Jake don't get included in those basically inner circles that everybody else, you know, knows about. And political problems.
Right, political. We don't know that we have a legislative body that we taught the three branches of government actually targeted our people in the legislative matter to write these grievous laws
yep.
to implement them down on us.
Yep.
Three strikes you out. Yeah. They used a lot of laws that they used for the mafia in the 50s and the 40s and the 30s called organized crimes,
mm-hmm.
shift them over to organized gang crimes to rope us all in as guilty by association.
Yep.
Which that's your family member.
Accomplice or something.
Yep. Yeah, accomplice. All of those. You, of course, if your cousin did something and came to your house, you ain't like you know he did it, so you let him into the house.
Right.
And they come in saying, oh, we have a body warrant for this person.
Yeah.
And we have, without reasonable doubt, that he's in your complex or in your home, your dwelling place. And they come in there and you get guilty by association.
Yeah. Okay, it says, reading from here, through its research impact, the prison industrial complex helps secure the authority of people who gather there, who gather, Slakia, I'm read it again. Through its reach and impact, the prison industrial complex helps secure the authority of people who get their power through racial, economic, and other structural privileges. Example, white people, American citizens, people with property, people with money, which is basically these devils, these Edomites, by defending current power distributions. It benefits government and industry, as well as those individuals who already hold power in our society. The process by which this unequal power is garnered and maintained include creating dominant media images that perpetuate stereotypes of people of color. Right. That goes to what? Those rap videos, those rap music industry. Basically, they, how can you say it? What they say, judging a book by its cover or something like that. Yeah. Because you in that neighborhood, that means you got to be either a gang member or a drug dealer.
Exactly. And not only that, but they also had another fold off of BET and things of that nature called culture creation.
Yep.
Where they actually knew that they put these rappers and these gangsters at this high status with Michael Jordan and the basketball players.
Yep.
And actually have us wearing the same clothes.
Yep.
So that's culture creation. That's why you see the young man walk around with their pants sagged.
So you already labeled as something that you maybe not a part of. But it says stereotypes of people of color, poor people, queer people, immigrants, youth, etc., as criminal, delinquent, or deviant. Right, so they already stereotyping the they're stereotyping Jake that he's a criminal, he's a delinquent, he's basically a no good, a troublemaker, you know. Earning huge profits for companies that provide goods and services to the prison industrial complex.
Right, like Bomb Barker. He have toothpaste and flip flops in the prison industry here in Wisconsin. And I have actually been down there and not visiting and actually have seen toothbrushes with his name on them and flip flops. Yep. And I have witnessed that with my own eye.
Yep. So they getting money made by supply
and demand.
Right.
Cell
supply,
phone companies.
Supply and demand, yep.
You got cell phone companies making money, charging a higher rate, and don't nobody care because don't nobody defend the criminal.
Yep.
You also have people being able to start small businesses up because because it's no coincidence that all the prisons are located up north in all 50 states. But what do they get majority of the bulk of that supply of inmates from? The cities where the Latins and basically where the Israelites dwell.
Yep.
And whites actually start small company business to transport your family up north because they know we don't have sufficient cars to go back and forth.
Yep. It says increasing the influence of facilitating political gains. Right. And what's his name?
Like you hear Tommy Thompson here. He was tough on crime.
Yep.
So he got elevated from being the criminal justice to actually moving up to the mayor to actually getting a job up in Washington as Health and Human Services, which he's fattest ever. And Wisconsin is one of the fattest states in all 50 states. So what the hell is he doing up there? But he did a good job when it comes to incarcerating the Israelites at a high alarming rate here in this state, Wisconsin.
Yep.
Like me, for instance, $200 of crack cocaine, I was facing 40 years for each count.
And that's how they're trying to get Jake caught up. By these unjust laws, you know. But it says, facilitating political gains, increasing the influence of prison guard and police unions.
Right, and they was able to do that because when they took the prisons up north, they had the substitute. The big farming industry, because Wisconsin used to be known as the dairy state.
Yeah.
It's not the dairy state, thanks to another agenda they had on top of this agenda of what's that name, that company? I always say wrong. Monsanto's.
Monsanto's?
Right. Of taking over all of the farming industry land and so forth and supplying those next generation farmers with work. It was called being a guard at the prison.
Yeah. It says social and political. Eliminating social and political dissent by people of color, poor people, immigrants, and others who make demands of self-determination and reorganization of power in the United States. Right. And what's the guy named Bill Clinton? He was known for starting or making the most prisons, and I think it was in the '80s. Was it in the '80s, Bill Clinton?
Yeah, nineties.
Yeah, Bill Clinton. Right when this was breaking out, and it show you at the end of this at the end of the video that we played. You know, we ain't play at all, but you can watch the whole 30 minutes yourself. But at the end, it shows Bill Clinton talking to Jake and basically asks him, oh, basically, why is this happening? Why is that happening? But underhand, not knowing that he a devil himself, and he the one who funded a majority of the prisons at that time.
Problem, reaction, solution.
You see that? Okay. So that's one document. Okay, we're going to bring something else in.
This is where your probation and your parole stem off of, and the history of the probation and the parole and the public pretender. Well, they call them public defenders, but we all know who've been a part of that system, that they public pretenders.
Right. Because when you got to have a, when Jay go to jail, they, like you brother said, they have those public pretenders to basically to make it seem like they're going to help you. Basically, lower level lawyers.
Right. Because you have to have counsel. Because due to your name being in all caps, thanks to Elder Gabbar breaking this down last week, but due to your name being in all caps, you consider dead to them. Because on your tombstone, if you look at everybody's tombstone, they have what? All capital letters. Yep. So since you're dead and you're not a part of their system, which system mean a pit, someone has to be a part of their system, and it's called a lawyer.
Yep.
Because the judge sit on what? The bench.
The
bench is to do what? Collect revenue.
Yep.
That's why you always get fined by the court.
Yeah. Okay, so this is guy, Clarence Earl Gideon. Okay, it's a documentary. I wish you're going to show a couple of clips of that. It's called Gideon's Army. And basically, he was a so-called poor Edomite who got helped by a top, what do they call him?
Basically, top governor official.
Right.
Which really he was sitting on the Supreme Court at once upon a time. But we're going to get into the history of this guy and take it step by step.
Yep. Okay, I'm going to just read this guy who they based this whole public defending stuff off of was this guy, this man right here. It says Clarence Earl Gideon was a poor drifter accused in a Florida state court of felony theft. His case resulted in the landmark U.S. Supreme Court decision, Gideon versus Wainwright, holding a criminal defendant who cannot afford to hire a lawyer must be provided with a lawyer at no cost. At Gideon's first trial, he represented himself and he was convicted. After the Supreme Court ruled that the state had to provide defense counsels for the indigent, Florida retired Gideon.
Right. Now, before the brother go any farther, let's go down into this guy, Clarence Earl Gideon's life when he was a kid. And let's see, was he able to have the reading capability and knowledge to go into the, what's that, the Greek?
Mm-hmm.
When you go into the law?
The Latin.
You have to go into the Latin.
Yeah.
Let's see if his early life consists of him being able to have that capability of doing that. Just go to his early life.
Right here?
Yeah, right there.
Okay, it says early life. Gideon was born in Hannibal, Missouri on August 30th, 1910, and his father, Charles Roscoe Gideon, died when he was 3. His mother was Virginia Gregory Gideon. Gideon quit school after 8th grade.
What? When did he quit school?
Quit school after 8th grade.
Now, you got to remember, this is back in 1910, the early 1900s. Mm-hmm. So they didn't have the reading and the math capability that you need right now to run the modern day society, which is this computer operated thing.
Yeah, technology.
Modern technology. Yeah. All they had was the Ford factory. Uh-huh. And Chrysler factory, it was simple math.
Yep.
You was doing basically only 10th grade math.
Mm-hmm.
So, and
it's that.
Right. So how was he able to quit at 8th grade and go and actually be able to write and write legislative law to get his appeal and things up in that higher court?
Right.
That's not even possible.
Nope.
We really ain't even got to read nothing else more about him on that. Okay. Let's see. Right. He was 8th grade and ran away from home, living as a homeless drifter. By the time he was 16. So it ain't like he decided to go back to school.
Right, right.
He was a lonely drifter just floating around. Committing burglaries and stuff. You know, being a vagabond. A vagabond. That's what he was being, his right. natural self. So this guy was used in a bigger plot agenda, but we will expose it later.
Okay. Okay, here you go. And his second trial, which took place in August 1963, was a lawyer representing him and bringing out for the jury the weakness in the prosecution case. Gideon was acquitted. Arrested first. That's it, I'm right?
Yeah, that was it. I'm
okay, good.
Now we're going to the lawyer that actually represented.
Here we go. His name is Abe Fortas. Now this is the
Associate Justice of the U.S. Supreme Court.
Right.
Abe, what, Fosters?
Fortas. Okay. It says Abraham or Abe Fortas was a U.S. Supreme Court Associate Justice from 1965 to 69. Originally from Memphis, Tennessee, Fortas became a law professor at Yale University.
That's one key. Yale, skull and bones.
Yep. And then an advisor for the U.S. Secretaries and Exchange Commission.
Right, so let's see what kind of clout they care.
This is the U.S. Secretary and Exchange Commission. It's an agency of the United States federal government. It holds primary responsibility for enforcing the federal securities laws and regulating the securities industry, the nation's stock and options exchange.
Right, so he dealt with the big exchange money, and he also made the laws that dealt with that.
Yep. It says, and other electronic securities markets in the United States.
Yeah. Okay.
So that's about it. It says, Fortas next worked at the Department of Interior. Let's see what that is. Did it pop in? Oh, there it is. It says, the United States Department of Interior is the United States Federal Executive Department. We're dealing with the president of the U.S. government, responsible for the management and conservation of most federal land and natural resources, and the administration of programs relating to American Indians, Alaska and Natives, Native Hawaiians, and territorial affairs, and insular areas of the United States.
Right, so this is another devil resigning over the 12, one of the brothers of the 12 tribes of Israel, all of them.
Yep.
Reubenites, the Gadites, the Issacharites, and he happened to go to Yale University.
Yep.
Yeah, we can get into it.
Okay. Isaiah 14:9. Right, so this now, a red flag should already have popped up by now, if you're watching. What is this? This guy who has all of this clearance and all of this, how can you say,
status.
14 and 9. This status, wasting his time to go to just, help out a poor white man who only stole, who stole a couple of items, right. being a drifter. Basically, that doesn't add up. That doesn't link up together.
Right. These two guys' lives don't consist of each other.
Yep.
When you have one at the highest positions you can get right. in the United States government to a guy who got one of the lowest
right.
you can get in the United States of America. So we basically tying how it's no coincidence that this guy represented him and actually brought in the public defenders due to him writing legislators saying that the man need counsel and it's not fair on what happened to him.
Right.
That's because it brings over on what you see today.
Yep.
So we're going to start on Abraham. Isaiah 14:9. Hail from beneath is moved for thee to meet thee at thou coming.
Yep.
It stirs up the dead for thee. Even all thou chief ones of the earth, it has risen up from their thrones. Oh, go down. Start at 10.
11. We said 11. Slack it.
Okay. Isaiah 14:11. Thou pomp is brought down to the grave.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning your pride.
Okay.
And the noise of thy vows, the worm is spread under thee, and the worms cover thee. That's y'all infrastructure yep. now falling apart. Because as you can see, and you look at this guy Dates, he was around the good old days.
Yep.
How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning, whom art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? And that's exactly what this man has been a part of, is residing over our brothers,
yep.
the Gadites, the Reubenites, and the Issacharites.
Right.
By taking their land and being a part of the legislative that actually write the grievous laws.
To keep them there.
To keep them on that land.
To keep them on the land. Yep.
That's toxin and got wastewater and so forth.
And poison liquor.
Yeah. For thou hast said in thou heart, I will ascend into heaven. Mm-hmm. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God.
Right, and that's what he's doing. Because you're going to find out that he is so-called Jew. We're going to read it. He's jumping it. But he's sitting in that seat exalting himself because he's dealing with the Lord's people. He is one of his top priorities is to deal with the Lord's people. Mm-hmm. And that's why they being brought down lower and lower. Because not just this guy, all the so-called Jews and everybody who had a hand in basically bringing the Israelites down.
I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the side of the north.
Yeah.
I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. That's his satellites and the planes up there.
Yeah, I think that's it.
Okay, yeah.
We got Ecclesiastes 10:7.
Ecclesiastes 10:7. I have seen servants upon horses and princes walking as servants upon the earth. Right? That's us, basically. We have these white devils sitting in these high positions, controlling our ancestors and our land that was given to us from Yahweh. From Yahusha, and they are sitting upon horses, meaning in power seats, and we sitting basically on the ground walking and don't have no power control of anything.
Yeah.
Not even no substance to even get attorneys, lawyers, our own land, our uh-huh. own farm, or anything. Even to this day.
Yep. Okay, this is Isaiah 10:1. Woe unto them that decree unrighteous decrees.
Right. So destruction unto Abe Foster,
mm-hmm.
who decreed, who made laws of righteous, mm-hmm. unrighteous.
Mm-hmm. And that right grievousness which they have prescribed. Right. They wrote that down.
And right. That's what this man has been doing. His whole career, he has been doing that. Since his first job after Yale,
yep.
after being with the good old boys, all the way until today.
Yep. It says to turn aside the needy from judgment.
Right. And they have turned aside the needy to judgment, having basically taken our land from us and turning mm-hmm. the Gadites and the Issacharites into drunks working mm-hmm. in these factories now, not even knowing that they even own any land.
And to take away the right from the poor of my people.
Right. What is the right that this land was given to us from Yahusha?
Yeah. And the law, statutes, commandments, and they corrupted, they polluted.
Yeah, thanks to that game.
Yep.
And them rap videos.
Right, because all they teach about is having sex with another man's wife, which is what, fornication.
Yeah.
Homosexuality they was pushing. Yeah. They was exalt pushing exalt. Yep. Yep.
Love knocked out, brother.
Yep. Yep.
Don't trust them niggas.
Yep. Murdering.
Yeah. Yeah, thou shalt not murder.
Yep.
The 613th commandment.
Yep.
Sagging the pants.
Yep.
Showing
yep.
of the buttocks. Sleeping with our father's wives.
Yep. Yep.
And
all
the
father that they push.
With everything.
Yep.
Everything you can think of that you don't.
Witchcraft.
To tattoos.
Yep. Right. Witchcraft.
Yeah.
Smoking and selling yep. those drugs yep. and the crack. You know, the epidemic on crack cocaine. This comes from all of this comes from these devils.
Other philosophies going to church.
Yep.
Worshiping another God.
Yep.
Sees your bonjour.
It says that widows may be their prey
right.
and that they may rob the fatherless.
Right.
And that's us.
They
we
robbed
the
us.
Yep.
And the widows was their prey. Why? Because they had another program going on through this time period as welfare and Section 8
uh-huh.
to get the man out the house. And give and set the woman up and debunk the order the Lord established.
Yeah.
What else we got?
Okay, wait.
Proverbs 4:16.
No, Micah 2:1, and then I'll get the Proverbs.
All right, Micah 2:1. Woe to them that devise iniquity and work evil upon their bed.
Right, that's these devils, the elites, the so-called decision makers.
Right.
Going back to that secret meeting. They basically strategized and came to one agreement on how was they gonna get Jake to get into those prison systems and how was they gonna implement it through the TV to get basically the whole world to go with that same philosophy. Because that's exactly what it is.
Yeah, it's one more order. Now it's complete.
Yep.
When the morning is light, they practice it.
Yep.
Because it is in the power of their hands.
Right, because they got the money for it.
And they cover fields and take them by violence.
Yep.
And houses and take them away. So they oppress a man and his house, even a man and his heritage.
Yep.
And that's what they did when they lumped us together with them dirty Africans
yep.
through their food system, they call school system.
Mm-hmm.
And told us that we was from Africa, and that's the motherland.
Okay.
And Africans sold Africans into slavery. So you coming over here was a good thing when you got off the boat. Even though they showed you, back in the day, they used to show you roots.
Mm-hmm.
They forgot about that.
Right. Okay, this is Proverbs 4 and 16. This is Proverbs 4 and 16. For they sleep not except they have done mischief. Right, they don't get no sleep unless they did something wicked and wrong. Okay, unless they devised a plot to how another way that Jake can be mine can be destroyed, and their sleep is taken away unless they cause some to fall.
Right,
that's,
man, that's hitting the hammer, the nail on the hammer right there.
Yep,
with a hammer on the nail. Excuse me.
Mm-hmm.
That's perfect because. That's how they set the school system up.
Yeah.
They set it up off the food system, school system,
mm-hmm.
off the third to fourth grade reading level of the kids to set up the population, the prison population for the next generation.
Yep.
See, illiteracy.
Yep.
They know if you can't read and you can't comprehend and you can't focus thanks to the lead and the mercury, not only in the water, but in the wall through the paint, then how are you going to get these jobs and be a skilled laborer? And be able to think outside the box and actually multitask. You're not going to be able to do that. And then they gave us so-called labels as ALD, learning disability.
Yep, ALD. Bridges, they gave put you in a class called Bridges with so-called mentally challenged students or, you know. It says, unless they cause some to fall,
right?
That's their main objective.
That some of y'all have to go. Some of you third, fourth graders, when they see you, I have actually had teachers tell us here in this little town, Kenosha, when I went to Frey School in fifth and sixth grade, that half of y'all going to prison.
It says, for they eat the bread of wickedness and drink the wine of violence. Right, that's all in their habitation. Habitation is to drink the bread of wickedness. Drink the wine of violence and to eat the bread of wickedness, right? And that's what they do. And how do they do it? Through the industry, through the music industry, through the prison systems. Because, and then another thing is when you go into those prison systems, they is filled with different philosophies. So Jay come out those prison systems, bugged out his mind even worse. 5% is right. Yeah, Islam
is big in the prison system. Big in the prison system. The gangs are big because they got more organization in there than outside on the streets.
Yep. So all of that prison system basically is a demonic force that was pushed and brought out. Because it's like another world inside the prison.
Yep.
Okay? And it is more wicked and demonicer, really, than being outside. Because you got a lot of philosophies and a lot of madness going on in those jails.
Homosexuality.
Yep. Rape. Okay, it says, but the path of the just is as the shining light that shineth more and more unto the perfect day. That's why we're bringing out these information.
The elect. The elect gonna be able to swim through all this murky water.
Yep.
And get to the living water from Yahweh Shah.
Okay. The way of the wicked is darkness. They know not at what they stumble.
Right. So we not like Lil Wayne and them other guys who into all that. Promoting like Dr. Dre and Snoop Doggy Dogg that promote this wickedness.
Mm-hmm.
In Psalms 94:20, shall the throne of iniquity have fellowship with thee, which frameth mischief by law?
Right. It's frameth mischief by law. Like the brother said, they got this three strikes you're out program. They got probation, guilty by association.
You want to be a lawyer?
Right, being a lawyer, you got to go through
the bar association.
Yeah, the bar association to be a lawyer. You gotta sign an oath to be a lawyer. Okay, you gotta
police officer.
Right, you gotta promote wickedness. And what I mean by that is you getting men or women who's guilty of murder. Or doing something wicked, and you basically got to go in and prove that they prove to the jury that they're innocent when they're really not. Right. That's wicked. And the real law is talking about the law, statutes, and commandments, which they corrupted. And then you put in this BS law, basically to be set over the real laws and statutes.
Right. So that's why Psalms 94 and say, "Show the throne of iniquity have fellowship with thee."
See?
Meaning, no, I'm not being a part of that stuff. Which frameth mischief by a law, and that's how they justify the law is good.
Yep.
What law? They gathered themselves together against the soul of the righteous and condemned the innocent blood. But the Lord is my defense, and my God is the rock of my refuge.
Yep.
So we're not going to be overtaken by these crafty devices of Satan.
This is Job 13:4. But ye are forgers of lies. Ye are all physicians of no value.
That's talking to you crackers.
Yep.
Y'all are forgers of lies. So this whole law y'all set up is all set up and based off of lies.
Okay.
That's why y'all use other people's accounts.
Yep.
Okay, this Proverbs 29:12. If a ruler hearken to lies, all his servants are wicked. And that's for all of y'all who want to join hand in hand and be a part of being lawyers and doctors and which you're supposed to be a physician, but lawyers and doctors and police officers and fire chiefs and things of that nature and being an army. The poor and the deceitful men meet together. The Lord lighteth both their eyes. That's it.
Okay, that's it on that. We're going to go back into this. You just have to bring them scriptures out. Because it's always backed up by the scriptures. Everything goes to the scriptures. Okay, now this is this Abe guy who so-called defended Gideon.
Start back up there,
okay, right here?
Yeah.
Oops. Okay, it says, Fortas next worked at the Department of the Interior under President Franklin D. Roosevelt.
Exactly.
And during that time, President Harry S. Truman appointed him to delegations that helped set up the United Nations in 1954.
See, this is how in-depth this man is, but you're going to tell me he's going to help this guy named Gideon. Come on, man. That's a joke.
Yep. Later on, in private legal practices.
So this is when he got done doing all his work for the elites, and he started to get on into his own legal private practices. Let's see what he was about.
Fortas represented Lyndon Johnson, LBJ.
See, that's the one who started the 501c3 church.
So-called Jew.
See, now you see what I said? They gathered themselves against the righteous.
Yep. Because they all is intertwined, interlinked with each other. And we're proving it right now.
This is the shadow government.
And the Hartley contested Democrat senatorial second primary electoral dispute.
Right. Help that man stay in.
Yeah, help him stay in. And he made close ties with the president-to-be.
Yeah, exactly.
Fortas also represented Clarence Earl Gideon, which is the guy who we talked about, who has no type of high standard, no type of status in the world, no type of money or wealth. Okay, so this was just, he basically stepped on this man to bring forth the agenda. Before the U.S. Supreme Court.
See that? Yep. The highest court, which he actually used to sit on the bench.
Yeah.
You see it?
Yeah, here you go. Associating Justice of the U.S. Supreme Court.
See, he actually set up there.
Yep.
Now, he representing this bomb against that. Come on. It was an agenda, and he fulfilled his agenda, and we're doing ours today.
Okay. And in case involving the right to counsel. Right, and the right to counsel is basically the right to have an attorney or a right for you to have basically your equal opportunity rights, so-called rights. As an appointee to the Supreme Court by Johnson, Fortas maintained a close working relationship with the president. Right, a close working relationship. And in 1968, Johnson tried to elevate Fortas to the position of Chief Justice. Mm-hmm. But that nomination faced filibuster because, at least in part, to the ethics problem that later caused him to resign from the court. Fortas returned to private practice, sometimes appearing before the judges with whom he had served and his successor, Justice Blackmun.
Okay, I got a scripture real quick.
Okay.
It's Ecclesiasticus 33:14. Good is set against evil, and life against death. So is the godly against the sinner, and the sinner against the godly. So look upon all the works of the Most High, and there are two and two, one against another. So he did his job, and we doing ours today. They devoured our people to justify us doing what we doing to condemn them in their society. See that? Good versus evil. Esau versus Jacob.
Is it?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just reading a little bit on his early years. Well, basically, we just
going to go through it.
Okay. It says, early years. Fortas was born in Memphis, Tennessee, the son of Ray Nee Burson and William Fortas. He was the youngest of the five children. His parents were...
You know who that sounds like? The Rothschilds. I mean, Myam M. Shambao and his sons.
Yep. Yeah, I thought about that last time when we were first going over it. His parents were Orthodox Jews.
There you go.
He was a so-called Jew. So no wonder he'd been involved in a lot of this. An Orthodox Jew were of British descent. And he might be one of the, you know, descendants.
Far-fetched.
Right. Were of British descent, and his father worked as a cabinet maker. Fortas acquired a lifelong love for music from his father, who encouraged his playing the violin and was known in Memphis as Phidian Abe Fortas. He attended public schools in Memphis, graduated from Southside High School.
Right, he was normal like everybody else.
In 1926, he next attended the Southwest at Memphis College.
Right, just like everybody else.
Graduating in 1930. Fortas left Memphis to enroll in Yale Law School.
I don't know how that happened.
Right, so now in law school. And that's Yale, the top demonic school there is. That, who was in? Bush,
Kerry.
Yep.
Bush.
John. Yep. Kerry.
Prime mate, running mate. But they both part of the same organization.
He graduated second in his class in 1933. And he was the editor in chief of Yale Law Journal. One of his professor, William O. Douglas, was impressed with Fortas, and Douglas arranged for him to stay at Yale, become an assistant professor of law. Right. So he basically been moving up in ranks his whole life, going back to him being a so-called Jew. Okay, that's pretty much it.
Okay, yeah, that's good.
Okay, now, last but not least, well, we have one more, is this document. Okay. This is going to bring in everything that we've been speaking about, is the redemption service. You can Google this, okay?
Expound on that. Yeah, it's basically just getting into the how the executive and legislative branch came together and put this whole prison industry together as a big new slave market for corporations, corporate slaves. Yeah. That's exactly what this is. It's finna get you into the history.
Yeah. After the eight?
Yeah.
After eight. Okay. But we'll put that in. Yeah. Alright. Shalakia brothers, we got a couple of clips to show you before we get into that.
Yeah. On exactly how this public pretender and system came into play.
Right.
Off of the documentaries, Gideon's Army.
Right.
Which she had expound on.
Go here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman, and we're broadcasting from the Sundance Film Festival in Park City, Utah. We turn now to a new film that looks at the struggles of public defenders, lawyers who dedicate themselves to representing the poor. In some states, it's estimated 80% of people facing felony charges cannot afford to hire their own lawyers. Often the lawyers appointed to handle their cases are faced with overwhelming caseloads and virtually no resources. The problem is especially bad in the South. The average caseload for a public defender in Miami-Dade County, Florida, at any one time is 500 felonies and 225 misdemeanors. Well, an HBO documentary premiering at this year's Sundance Film Festival follows three public defenders in states like Georgia that fight the odds to provide their clients with quality representation. This is a clip from the film Gideon's Army that explains just what's at stake.
This is the way it really works. You go to jail. You're charged with an offense based upon what a police officer thinks you did. They set a bond, and if you're poor,
right,
and you can't make the bond, you don't get out. So you sit, and you sit, and you sit. You may have lost your house. Your kids may be needing sustenance. You may have been taken out of high school. All the things that could happen if you were summarily plucked from your life. You have so much tremendous pressure to plead guilty. It's all about lessening the penalty.
That's an excerpt from the film's title, Gideon's Army, which refers to the landmark Supreme Court case, Gideon v. Wainwright.
That's pretty much it on that. And that whole Gideon's Army came from that guy, Gideon. It was basically on how it got started.
Right, so it started the slave market.
Yep. All about the slave market, like the brother said. Now we got a few clips that we're going to show from that documentary, Gideon's Army.
Now. I speak with Ms. Howard? Ms. Howard, how are you? How are you? This is Brandy Alexander over at the Public Defender's Office in Clayton County. I got a letter from the DA's office today indicating that they have referred him to the pretrial diversion program. Are you familiar with that at all? It would allow him to have his charges dismissed. Now, in order to get him in the pretrial diversion program, he's going to have to get out of jail. You think you'll be able to do that? I know it's a lot, Ms. Howard. I know the average person cannot come up with $3,000 in a month or in less than a month. Is there any amount that you can afford? Okay. Your mom has $500. How much do you have? Is his... He's gonna have to choose between the trial and the suit.
Being a public defender, you realize very quickly the reality is 90% of the people or 95% of the people who get charged with something plead guilty to something, right? Because the system is designed to force them to plead guilty, and it punishes their failure to comply.